Okay. Well, welcome everyone to our first book group meeting. I'm a little overwhelmed at how much interest there's been, and I'm really excited about that. I think that's great. I love these books, and and I just feel really passionate about the project of all of us getting together and dissecting them a little bit and sucking the juices out of the meaning that's so inherent in every page, in every paragraph. So, so I'm really glad to welcome you and welcome other people who are joining us kind of from afar. There's people in Sweden and England who are participating at long distance, if you like. So they're reading their chapter and preparing their questions and sending them through to me each week. And some of them are also going to start having their own book meeting with a small group as well. Once hopefully these videos will go up onto YouTube, so they will have the benefit of our discussion as well, because some of them are small groups. And so I guess I should let you know that we're going to be recording everything. and hopefully that's okay with you. If it's not, well, you probably need to just watch on YouTube yourself as well. Because we can't really edit you out. My big desire for this group is that it becomes just a very relaxed discussion amongst us of these books. So the more we can kind of forget about the cameras, which is what I'm going to try and do, the better. And I was saying before, I feel a bit awkward having a microphone, because I did really just desire that this would be a group amongst friends discussing some beautiful material, and I'm going to lead and give some direction to our discussion to make sure we all stay on track. But I definitely, this is very much as much your group and about your learning as much as it is about my learning as well from this material. So it's not so much me teaching you as perhaps leading this discussion. Yeah. Part of the reason I'm so passionate about these books is that they lead me into a lot of self-reflection. Has anyone never read the books before and is reading for the first time? Awesome. Okay. And so am I to assume that all of you have finished this book before, all of the others? Yep. Who found it tough to read? Yeah. Yeah, and that easier the second time. Yeah, and that's very interesting. Oh, we need to use microphones as well. Sorry. So who's got microphones? Renee and Joy. Okay. So we should probably just do some basic core business before we start. I'm rushing ahead. So we're going to have microphones. If you can just raise your hand when you want to share something, and the mic will come to you. We're just going to run pretty much through the material. It'll probably take a couple of hours, depending on how involved you guys want to get and in your sharing and reflection. So we won't break, but there are loos off to the side, so you know. And the reason we've set up this way is so that you can enter and go to the toilets and do all those kinds of things without interrupting the flow of the group and the focus of the group. So. Yep. Any questions about general running of things and dates and times and places? Because they are a bit higgledy-piggledy. Nina, just Joy, if you can.
It's not a question so much as I noticed on your blog that the 4th of April...
I changed it. Okay. Yeah. So it should read the 3rd of April. Thank you.
So it's a Tuesday.
It is a Tuesday. Yeah. So that's amended on the blog, so just check. And if we do make any changes at the last minute or something like that, I'll let you know the week before, but also check the blog. I'll keep that up to date with exactly when we're meeting and where. So the reason we're not at a regular time is just to try and fit in around AJ and my schedule, and also around the bookings that we were able to get in the local area. So we weren't always able to have this space on a Thursday. And next week we're starting karaoke, so we thought we should just combine the whole shebang in the one venue, because we'll be bringing the same equipment. So that's why next week we're on a Wednesday. It's not essential that you come to every group, but I would ask that if you come, that you have completed the reading and the questions for yourself in your own time before you arrive here. That's because I feel that that's quite a loving thing to do for everyone else in the group. And also, the reason for meeting or exploring this material is to hopefully encourage self-reflection within each of you. And if you haven't done the reading or done the questions, then you're kind of missing the point. And it's more like coming to a lecture or coming to take from the experience of others. And I very much desired to do something a little bit different with these groups, and that is to help you all explore your own relationship with God and explore the meaning of everything that AJ's been teaching you for 4 years in your own lives, in your own time. And so that's why I asked that you would read and do the questions before you come. Yeah. And if you miss a week, that's fine. Just keep reading and doing your questions at home. And whenever you can come, come. So does that sound fair to everyone? Does anyone have any questions about that? Yeah. Okay. Cool. Okay. All right. Now let's get down to business. So I was going to talk about finding it difficult to read these books. So the first book, just for the benefit of the video, hi, welcome. The first book that we're covering is Through the Mists. It's channeled material. It was channeled by Robert James Lees from a spirit named Frederick Winterly was his name when he was on Earth, but he was renamed Afra, or he took the name Afra in the spirit world. So we'll refer to Afra or Frederick as we go along. So they were channeled at the start of last century, and I believe that they didn't have a lot of success. They certainly were out of print by the end of the century, which, I mean, perhaps they had a lot of success in the early part of the century, but they're certainly not still regarded as common truths. And much of what we explore and much of what is written in here is about the fact that a lot of the Earth's perception of truth and love and God is actually in error, which is why I feel that it is such a gift that Afra gave to all of us, and such a service that Robert James Lees undertook in taking down all this material, because this is the first of three books. So it's no small feat. And for those of you who are mediums or in the mediumship team or wanting to develop your mediumship, something that I reflect on as I'm reading is what a gift of service this medium gave to us all. And clearly he needed to be in a good enough condition to receive these truths. And in the preface, I think that he remarks on that with love that we can receive more truth. And that was Afra's experience in the spirit world, but also Robert James Lee's. So, yeah, just a very beautiful gift. Okay, so who wants to share their impressions of reading so far? Who read the preface? Yep. And what struck you about the preface? Anyone? Joy?
The first paragraph actually brought up a lot of grief for me in the fact that he really wanted to do this. It was his hope and endeavour to reach and comfort a few of the wounded sons and daughters. So we've got this great gift, but he was happy. He would do it, I feel, even if it just reached one person. And that really touched something in my soul.
Yeah. It's a very pure desire that he has, isn't it? The desire to... And that's something that struck me reading the preface and Afra's words, and in the first chapter even. Immediately we're struck, aren't we, by how sincere his desire is to ease the suffering of other people while he was on Earth, and then immediately that he enters the spirit world. Yeah, yeah, very beautiful. Yeah. Anyone else? Jen? Just wait for the mic. Yeah.
Right at the very beginning, the poem really struck me. There's just so much misunderstanding I have about what the spirit world's going to be like for me. What am I going to experience? Am I actually making progress? And in the poem, right at the very beginning, there's this deep, deep desire that's expressed to just have it all flung open and a light shine, you know, so brightly that you know, the mists are parted and you can see which way you're going. So that helped me with my desire and to face the fear that I actually still have of dying.
Yep. So this effort to throw open wide the mists and that we might understand what's happening after death. Certainly, it's a beautiful thing that he desires to do. But what I find as I read these things is that, read all of the books, is that he's giving us messages not just about what happens after we die, but he's giving us many messages about how we live on earth and how that affects our soul and our spirit body. And that is one of the reasons why I think we often find it very difficult to read, especially initially. Because if we read these books with a closed heart or with resistance to truth, it's very challenging. Someone emailed me and said that they couldn't understand why they found it difficult to read the books. They thought that perhaps it was written in an awkward way on purpose so that we had to digest these truths very slowly. Now, I don't agree with that because the more I read and the more I open to truth and open my heart, I find it's just beautiful. It's like poetry on every page and there's so much meaning and depth of meaning that I seem to be able to explore and discover through the reading. However, when I first sat down to read them, I was very closed to truth. I was closed to having... If you think about it, he's talking about the way we live on earth, the way we treat other people, the way we view God, the way we view love. And he's challenging those things that are still core beliefs, core erroneous beliefs that are held on the planet. He's challenging them on every page. And unless we're open to that challenge, I think it becomes heavy going because our soul's in opposition to his soul, if you like. The more I open, the more I go, wow. Wow, and I can't put it down then. But initially I was like labouring, this was 4 years ago, I was labouring through every sentence and going, what does he really mean? I can't get that. And I blamed the language, like the very sort of old English language. I still think there's a few issues surrounding language and part of what I want to do is talk about definitions of words and things that are used in here because it can be off-putting. And... Yeah, I read with the dictionary and the Bible, and I wanted to tell you about that because I think that's good. So there's lots of beauty in the Bible. I didn't used to think so, but there's a lot of beautiful things in there, and especially a lot of the things that he references, the different parables he speaks of, and there's certain... terms of like house of many mansions and things that are commonly used in the Bible. Now, has anyone had absolutely no contact with the Bible and has a huge resistance to it? Yeah, so a few, but not as many as I thought. I haven't been raised a Christian or anything. I've obviously had contact with the Bible, but not in this life. And I've had a lot of anger about certain things that were untruth in the Bible, so I've never really explored the Bible. So now I want to, as part of this opening up process, I really want to, but I don't know what he's talking about all the time. So luckily I live with Jesus and he's got a few Bibles, but he also has this awesome thing called a concordance. Has anyone ever heard of them before? Not yet. Deb, you have. Basically, it's like a dictionary. It's got all these different words listed in alphabetical order. So this one, deficient. And then underneath that, it lists where the word deficient is listed in the Bible. So you can actually... So deficient is in Daniel 5:27. Balances and have been found deficient is the phrase that it's in. So... If you have one of these, then you can look, and we'll do it later when he talks about the parable of Dives and Lazarus, but you can easily find what it is that he's referring to in the Bible rather than going, how do I know? So a concordance can really help open up the meanings that he's trying to convey as well. Otherwise, I believe there's quite a few versions of the Bible now online, and so you can just search for the word and it will do a similar thing for you. Yeah. And the other thing that I've been reading with is a dictionary, or Google dictionary. Google's pretty awesome, hey? What are we going to do without Google? Yeah. So I would recommend that because it also adds a lot more depth to what I've been reading. Yeah. Okay. So back to the preface. Any other impressions? Alex?
Just on that point where you're talking about the language, I've really struggled with this for the last 3 years reading these books, and I've put it down and taken them up, but just still had this desire to read it. And it wasn't until we started doing this exercise that I actually really connected to the rage I had about what's this guy talking about? Why can't he just say what he means? Why? Just like absolute rage, and I didn't know why I had this rage in me. Yeah. And then I realised it was actually about not being able to understand my father.
Right.
So it was actually an emotion that it was related to.
Yeah.
As soon as I just touched upon that truth or felt that truth, I started to understand it all.
Yeah.
So it was like this huge block that I went through with these, that I've struggled with for so long with these books. Yeah.
Awesome. I mentioned that to AJ yesterday, that I have a lot of blocks. I don't have a lot of blocks around language, but I have huge blocks around mathematics because I feel like that's an area where I feel stupid and I don't want to feel stupid. But I was remarking to him that I think equally people have been made to feel silly or stupid or unintelligent around the issues of language. And so hitting a word that I don't understand can trigger not just, oh, what's that word? How can I learn? Like a lot of rage or a lot of resistance to the material. So awesome. And this is the beauty of like setting ourselves a task for a week and going for it. It brings up heaps of stuff. Joy was telling me it brings up all this stuff around school, having to do your homework. Yeah. And my response to that is, yeah, I agree. It did bring up sort of like that for me too. I'm going to ask people if they've done their homework, and if they haven't, they have to go, you know. But I also feel that we're very used to having things, especially now at this time in history, having things handed to us on a platter. And we talked about that a bit in the US. I can't remember if it was in a talk or just between us about how there's a society that's very used to getting everything very quickly, including their spiritual enlightenment. And they go to church and it's like a big concert and it's wonderful and you come out feeling the glory of God, but how much of yourself did you really bring there and how much of yourself did you challenge and how much of your own spiritual development are you engaged in? And I suppose that in doing some homework, we're engaging ourselves. And so I don't have a sense that I need to check your homework, but if you don't feel like you want to do your homework, there's definitely some emotions there surrounding, maybe it's about school, but maybe it's about how much do I really want this growth? How much do I really want to know God and bring this soul into alignment with love? Because it's going to take effort on our part. It's just gonna, because we're in a lot of error now. The whole world's in a lot of error, and it's going to take some effort. Yeah. If we go Graham and then Barbara.
One issue I've had with deciding whether I wanted to come or not was firstly the homework thing. I brought back memories of high school, but also felt like, well, is it making it all too intellectual for me? Like, I have enough trouble with being intellectual with stuff as it is.
Yeah.
And it has felt to me like analysing and picking it all apart and all that sort of stuff and having to say what it all brought up for me and all that sort of stuff. Sometimes it feels like what I'm feeling can't really be put into words.
Yeah.
And when I try to put it into words, it somehow rather cruels the feeling.
Yeah. And you don't have to put it into words. it was more... And it's more about asking yourself to reflect on those things. So there's two things, isn't there? There's a resistance to needing to do homework and write it all down. But sometimes that can be a resistance to our emotion. As we talked about, it can be a resistance to school, or it can be a resistance to this feeling like, I don't want to actually explore what I feel. I just want to feel it and then get on with it, but I'm actually skipping over the emotion. So it can be about that. At other times, it can just be that, yeah, I feel completely overwhelmed and I can't analyse this and I don't want to cheapen it by writing in a journal about it. And that's totally fine also. These sessions are not going to be about all of us sitting around talking about our feelings per se. It's going to be reflecting on how these truths impact on our life, reflecting on what when he's talking about love, when he's talking about service, well, how does that relate to us? And what does that mean in my day-to-day life? So this is not like a workshop where we're going to come and all cry it all out together. That's not my desire. And I don't think it's your desire either, is it, Graham? Does anyone have that desire? 'Cause no. The more I go on, the more I feel that our relationship with God is very personal. And we can do things that are going to help us reflect and grow in that relationship. And perhaps there's things we can do together to assist each other to reflect. But we're not going to get there by holding each other's hands, which sounds a bit harsh to my own ears, but it's true. We want to hold God's hand and speak the truth and be loving to our brothers and sisters. That's the biggest way we're going to support them. Yeah, so I hope that dispels some of your concerns, Graham. Okay, Barbara?
I struggled with reading through these books because of my all of the hard words in there.
Yeah.
And being angry with myself for being so dumb.
Yeah.
So I put the books down many times. I even had a dictionary. Then Googled the words and all of those things. But I have dyslexia, but I think I've used that as an excuse to not to face the injury of feeling so dumb and stupid all my life.
Yeah, yeah. So that's awesome that it's helping you confront some of those feelings.
That's right, because when I had to do it on my own, I would just put it down and avoid the emotion, but doing it for this homework, I've had to face it more honestly.
Yeah. And have you found that you're finding more meaning in it now? Now that you're sort of feeling some of that?
Absolutely. Yeah. I still have to use the dictionary though. Yeah. And if I haven't heard a word, I can't pronounce it.
Yeah.
You know, still.
Yeah.
There's in the first chapter, there's a word in the first sentence that I still can't pronounce.
Yes. Well, let's have a game. Who knows how to pronounce that word? I call it misanthrope. Is that what you say? Yeah, yeah, yeah. At the back, Geraldine. Sorry, just wait for them.
The way I've heard it pronounced is misanthropy.
Misanthropy, okay, yeah. Cool. Thank you. So you're not alone, Barbara. I had the same feeling though. I feel really stupid reading this because I don't understand anything. Yes, awesome. Okay, let's finish just talking a few more points about the preface and then we'll start on the first chapter and we can talk about the meaning of misanthropy. Yeah. Okay, so I suppose the points that I wanted to raise about the preface, both prefaces, were just those things that I touched upon, which was about the gifts that Afra so desperately desires to give to us and the service that Robert James Lees gave to us in presenting these truths. And at the end of the preface, Afra says through Robert, "May God, the Father of souls of all men, bless this effort of a yearning heart to lift a portion of the weight of ignorance from the shoulders of the brethren in the flesh, and grant that the light of its truth may be a lamp unto their feet in coming through the mists." Which is such a beautiful sentiment, isn't it? That he desires to demystify this process of dying and death for all of us. But I see, as I also highlighted earlier, that he gives us the gift of truth of not just what happens as we come through the mists, but also how what we do right here and now is affecting how our soul is growing or shriveling and how it will affect us when we do pass through the mists. So I thought that it's a much bigger gift than he even envisaged, perhaps. I also felt that many of the things that he highlights and he talks about, some of the reasons why I found it so hard to read the first time is that I didn't want to feel what was happening in this soul and how I was affecting the people around me. But that as we open up emotionally, we do automatically become more sensitive to some of the things that he talks about, excuse me, some of the errors when we're acting upon them, we start to feel them. Does anyone else feel that? Like, this feels bad, yeah. And I guess that that's why we can feel it's the truth often as well, isn't it? Because we're reading it and we're saying, yeah, wow, I can feel what he's saying there because I can feel that in me, how when I've been unloving, this is going to be affecting me, or how when I do have that pure desire for service and love of another person, how it opens me and I feel bigger and I can love myself more even. So, yeah, that was my comments about the preface. Just one more thing. And that is in the last paragraph of the second preface, so the preface to the third impression. I found this very beautiful, and he's referencing Paul in Corinthians, but he says, he's talking about the gift of mediumship, but he's also talking about God's love. So he says, God giveth to every man severally as he will. I thought this was worth our reflection. So he's saying that God gives to all of us, but he may give each of us different things and different gifts, and that it is his will that he would do those things. And that's a gift of, I see that as a gift of pretty pure love. How does everyone else feel about that? Nothing? We can, Nina? Just wait. Yeah. I know it's a bit off-putting waiting for the mic, but
That in part brought up a question for me in that I don't know if I'm skipping ahead, but there were people, which I was really touched by, that when they got through the mist, there were so many people there supporting that process.
Yeah.
And there was two questions around that, is that do children get supported first specifically? And people who go through the mists in really poor soul condition, I first asked the question that do they get support, but then I felt that maybe they didn't get support because they weren't in a condition to receive it.
Mm. I think both those questions are better if we come to them in the first chapter. So if you can remember those questions, I'll come back to you, because it is actually, some of that is answered in the first chapter. So I just want to stay with this quote around the gifts of mediumship at the moment, okay?
Gifts from God.
Okay. Yeah. So in the end of the first second preface, he's talking about the gifts that God gives us in terms of our talents and abilities. I should specify that more. Okay? So in terms of what we're able to do, what our unique personality, some people are gifted in athletics or in poetry or in mathematics. So we're talking about
The gifts we receive from God are in part related to our unique personality?
Definitely. Yes. Yes. Do you not see that? Yeah. Okay. Let me go on a bit, because I'll make my point a little clearer before we talk any more about it. Okay. So as Paul says to the Corinthians, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. So in that he's saying that there are many different things that we might be given in our life, but it is the same Spirit of love with which they're given. And he says that there are differences in administrations but the same Lord, which is the same point. There's different ways that God acts in our life and different ways he shows us love, but it is the same love that God is inherent in the workings of the way God gives us gifts, both in our nature and personality, but in our life. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. Now, I wanted to ask you what you thought about that last sentence. What does he mean by that? Zenko?
Well, for me, it was the beautiful gift of free will.
Uh-huh.
And the power of free will to manifest whatever it is that to create.
Yeah. I do agree that's a huge gift that God's given to all of us. But what I feel he's saying is the manifestation of the Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit that gives us these gifts, is the divine love. And we can all receive that. We can all access that. We can all profit from that. So we may have many different gifts and talents in our life, and we may have many different things that are given to us in our life. But the one thing that we may all profit from, that we may all access, is the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, which is love. Yeah. And that's very beautiful, Renee.
It brought up for me to reflect on what my passions and desires and who I actually am, and the amount of arrogance that I have around mediumship and being good at something.
Yeah.
And so because I've wanted to avoid that feeling of arrogance, I haven't allowed myself to really feel what I truly desire. But the pain of not being who I am is starting to get greater than my wanting to avoid the arrogance.
Yeah. So really, you have a passion for mediumship, but you want to avoid the fact that you become arrogant when you do mediumship. So it's not really arrogance that you're avoiding. It's a deeper emotion that you're avoiding that's creating the arrogance, isn't it? Yeah. 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 It's a good point.
And I'm completely blank to what that emotion is at the moment. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not going to go into it now, but yeah. Yeah. So I just thought that was a really beautiful quote. And then he goes on to talk about, because I understand in most Christian faith that in Corinth, that because Paul spoke about followers of Christ having the gift of speaking in tongues, of mediumship basically, that it is commonly held belief in Christian faith now that that gift has been withdrawn. And Robert James Lees goes on to make the point that the spiritual gifts were to be the heritage of the followers of Christ is surely beyond question. That they were not intended to be withdrawn, but were promised to as many as the Lord our God shall call. The history of saints in all ages and the invasions of the present day testify, for God is no respecter of persons, and whatsoever he doeth, it shall be forever. And he says, I can say no more. So what does he mean by God is no respecter of persons? Ange?
As the sun shines upon every creature on the planet or every person on the planet, so is God's love equal for all of us?
Yes. That's what yeah. And that he's given this gift of mediumship to people who wish to connect with him,
yeah.
And he hasn't withdrawn it because he doesn't play favourites with people. Yeah. 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 Suze?
It's really interesting, Mary, because I never read it as being just mediumship. I read it as being all the amazing, the incredible diversity of our personalities, and whether it's music, like we saw in the concert, I mean, it could just take your breath away, the gift that some people had.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so sometimes I think it's painful. You just have to wait to find out what your treasure is.
What your treasure is, yeah. 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 And I guess I agree that there's so much in that quote that's about all of us and all of our passions and God's love for all of us. Yeah. He's making the point about mediumship.
Is it? Yeah, I missed that then.
Yes. Yeah. He's very specifically saying, because he's copped a lot of flack for publishing this book. You know, people have said, you can't do that, it's not Christian. And so he's responding in the preface and saying, well, no, the gifts of mediumship were given to the followers of Christ, and God doesn't take away what he, you know, he's given it and never withdrawn it, as some people say that that has been done. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the latter part of your point, talking about waiting to find your passions, why do you think it's waiting that you find... Why do you use the word waiting?
Because I feel probably for myself, but I also watch my children, and I watch a lot of humanity, and I feel like a lot of us are just aching for God's love and for the truth of who we are.
Yeah.
And for a vast complexity of reasons. In fact, one of the things that I think that the book shows is that even when it seems that we're disadvantaged in life, and you can see that maybe somebody who's rich isn't advantaged at all, because yeah. there's all the beautiful laws and cross-checks and balances that make everything very fair in the end, even though on the surface it may not look like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't think I can answer your question.
Yeah. Well, the reason that I picked up on it is that I just feel that very often, and I do believe it's possibly a large part of Christian faith as well, there's a sense of, well, we have to wait to see what God's got in store for us. We've got to wait to know what God's will is for us. We've got to wait to find out who we are. When really what Afra demonstrates all the way through these books is he wants to know. He's on a mission. From the minute he crosses the mists, he's like, what's going on here? How can I find out more? What? Who are you? And you know, and everyone's going, whoa, I can't even answer your questions yet. And so I guess something that I feel about him, that I admire in him, and that I'm trying to establish more in myself is this, he's on a passionate journey to find out the truth of everything. And so he's not waiting. Mm-hmm. And yeah. So yeah, I just thought that was, no worries. Alex?
Just on that point of mediumship, I just had the realisation this morning, talking to Monique about, as we were doing our homework, that I just really had this huge desire to actually serve through mediumship, you know, and we've got a lot of desires, the two of us, a lot of desires, but to... mediumship seems like it's just so far and above all the rest of them, to be honest.
Yeah.
And but to actually serve through that, and you know, I know I've been very arrogant in the past with that.
So how do you think you serve well through mediumship, Alex?
I can't describe that. All I can say is, like, AJ encouraged me to be in the environment team, and I hated it and I didn't want to do it, but he said it'd be good for me. And it's been awesome in the last few times I've been. And whenever I leave the environment team, I just feel love because I'm serving. And I've just come to the realisation of how much better it is to give than to receive. And so just through that, I now feel like just apply that to my mediumship, to give. And how beautiful that is.
Hmm. Well, I think...
And there's issues of humility there as well, and a shitload of injuries and stuff.
Yeah, the way that we serve well through mediumship is by remaining humble.
Yeah.
That, and also having a respect and a desire for truth, both personal, from the spirits, and to give that gift to the person we're using our mediumship for. Now, clearly Robert had that desire because he channeled some pretty accurate material. But so that is the issues, that if you desire to use mediumship in service, I feel that there's a lot of lessons also in these books around service, because it's not just to give. And that's something that is talked about perhaps in the first or the second chapter, is about the feeling we have in doing things. And let's get on with talking about the chapter, because a lot of these themes come up anyway. So, okay. So there's just a few things. The first... does anyone want to give me the definition of the word misanthropy? Go, Barbara.
Look it up. I abbreviated it just to my words, dislikes and distrusts other people and avoids them at all cost.
Yes. Yep. Yep. And my definition told me it was about humankind and human society, feeling a mistrust or dislike of those things. So, yeah. So this is how we meet Frederick. He's admitting that this is how he's always been. He's been someone who doesn't trust or like humanity very much. Jason?
The definition I looked up was even more intense. It was around hatred.
Wow. Okay.
Which went back to a Greek definition.
Yep.
Yeah, so yeah. It was, and I could relate that too, around always judging.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And as he talks in the first chapter, so what do we learn about him in the start of the chapter? He talks briefly about his life on earth. What do we learn about him? Barbara?
I instantly felt that his distrust and dislike for society was for the privileged society.
Yes.
He actually respected and had a desire for the lesser people.
Yes.
So I learnt from that there was a man there who wanted the privileged society he felt was very unfair, and he wanted to give to the of himself
he felt
the truths and share with the people who society classified as ignorant or unworthy or unjust to receive the truths or knowledge in life.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
So
he felt disillusioned, didn't he with did. The way he saw the world around him operating. And there's a very strong theme in there around religion as well, isn't there? His father is a strict Presbyterian man who has some wealth which affords him respect in the church, and he feels quite a lot about duplicity and hypocrisy, doesn't he? Yeah. So obviously he's come from a place in his life where perhaps he felt a lot of judgment about what was happening around him. He certainly decided he didn't want to be a part of it. He didn't want to live in the mainstream, did he? Yeah. Joy?
And some of that seemed to be based on his observation that the way the church operated and acted was totally the opposite to how he interpreted the Bible and the teachings.
Yes, that's right. And he references the parable of Dives and Lazarus. Who knows the parable of Dives and Lazarus? No, I've got my copy here to read. Did anyone look it up? Did anyone go, oh, I don't know what that means? Who went, oh, I don't know what that means? Yep, yep, yep. Did anyone look it up after they went, oh, I don't know what that means? Yeah, Barbara? Awesome. Yep. So do you want to give us a summary of what it says? I'm going to read the proper parable, but yeah. What's he mean? Why does Frederick reference it?
Well, it's exactly what he saw in his own life, actually. The privileged not having any respect for what they had and the abuse of it and not wanting to give any to the needy and not wanting to share. And he saw that in his own life.
Yes.
So this parable was life
about
being played
that,
out.
Isn't it? Yeah. So he says at the bottom of page 3, I could never understand the righteousness of poverty here and damnation there, or the logical sequence of riches here and salvation there. So he's saying he sees society running in this way, that everyone who's rich is apparently going straight off to heaven and everyone who's in poverty is damned to hell. And he couldn't understand that. It was not according to my reading of the Bible or the teachings of Jesus in the parable of Dives and Lazarus. So the parable of Dives and Lazarus is in Luke. Luke 16.
Mary, I'd love to read it out to you, but there's a word there that I can't pronounce.
Well, let's read it out of this Bible because it's a New World Translation, because that's what we have at home. But that means it's written in very plain language, so it's lovely. It's very easy to read. Luke 16, And now I've lost my... 16. There we go. So Jesus is speaking to a group and he says, "But a certain man was rich, and he used to deck himself with purple and linen, enjoying himself from day to day with magnificence. But a certain beggar named Lazarus used to be put at his gate, full of ulcers and desiring to be filled from the things dropping from the table of the rich man. Yes, too, the dogs would come and lick his ulcers." So he's a very rich man who's got a wonderful life, and Lazarus is a beggar who's brought into his home, who's just there to eat the crumbs off the table, and he's so lowly in the eyes of everyone in the household that even though his skin is all ulcerated, the dogs are licking his sores. "Now, in course of time, the beggar died, and he was carried off by the angels to the bosom of Abraham." Now, Abraham is considered to be someone like really good. Someone else who's been a Christian can tell me why he's like super good. But he's obviously in heaven with God. And Lazarus has gone to be with Abraham. Also, the rich man died and was buried. And Hades, he lifted, and in Hades, which is another term for hell, he lifted up his eyes, he existing in torment, and he saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in the bosom with him. So he's in the hells and he sees Abraham and he knows that this poor beggar is now with him and he's in the hells. So he called and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in anguish in this blazing fire." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that you received in full your good things in your lifetime, but Lazarus correspondingly the injurious things. Now, however, he is having comfort here, but you are in anguish. And besides all these things, a great chasm has been fixed between us and you people, so that those wanting to go over from here to you people cannot, neither may people cross over from there to us." So he's saying, "You're in hell, and I can't help you." Because why is he in hell? Why is he in hell? What did he do on earth?
He was of lacking of love and compassion in his life, yes, for his brothers and sisters.
Yes, and he had a lot and he didn't choose to do anything with that apart from enjoy his own life. He ignored the poor welfare of others around him. So what Frederick is saying, I read that bit in the Bible and I thought, yeah, that's not loving to ignore the lot of people who are less fortunate, and he lived his life differently. Even though the church told him that it was the wrong thing to do. And he speaks in there, doesn't he, about a vicar telling him that his way of thinking is very wrong. Yeah. I just wanted to read to you the last part of that parable because I actually felt it was really relevant, and I'd never read this parable before, but very relevant to life. So the rich man is now speaking to Abraham and he says, "Then he said, in that event I ask you, Father, to send him to the house of my father, for I have five brothers, in order that he may give them a thorough witness that they also should not get into this place of torment." So he's saying, okay, you can't save me, but please, could you please like manifest yourself on earth again and tell everyone the error of my ways. But Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to these." Then he said, "No, indeed, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to see them, they will repent." But he said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone rises from the dead." So what do you take from that, Jen?
So if you're clouded over in your life, with all that you're doing and all that you have, and you can't see what's right at the tip of your nose, then no great manifestation is going to make any difference.
Yeah.
Because you've chosen to stay in a cloud.
Yes. Yeah, it's about being open to truth, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's about, he's saying, no, but really if something amazing happened and someone went down and told them, then they'd all listen.
It's also about opportunities, that in every day we have so many opportunities to look for ways to grow and
to receive
be
truth.
In truth.
Yeah.
Speak truth. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very much about him saying, I want the truth to be known about what the error. And Abraham saying to him, unless a person is open to the truth that's already there in their lives, how are they going to be open to anything else that happens? And if you think about that, that's very relevant for our own lives, isn't it? How much truth needs to be presented for us to sort of go, oh, maybe I really need to think about this and apply this. How many people have to come back from the dead? And how many people are really listening? Yeah, so I just thought that was an interesting end to the parable. It's not so much what Frederick was talking about, but yeah. Okay, so moving on to the chapter, just quickly to summarise what happened. Jane, can you tell me what happens in the chapter? So we learn about Frederick, we learn a bit about his nature and his life on earth, and then what happens? Just wait for the mic to come. Yeah.
And then basically he ends up seeing the little boy.
Yep.
Who's running in front of the horses.
Yep.
And he goes to grab him and then he just finds himself in just another world.
Yes.
Pretty much, yep. So yep. He's describing the rest of the chapter, he describes about what he's seeing around him and, and
he's sort of shocked and
yeah,
what's happened.
Shocked. Yep. And asking a lot of questions. You can see straight away he's got that inquisitive mind, wanting to know.
Yep. Beautiful. Thank you. All right. So does everyone agree that's a good summary? Yep. Let's get on to our questions, which is the core business. So the first question that we were to talk about was what issues of God's truth are demonstrated in this chapter. So we've talked a little bit about the themes already, but what are the issues of universal truth that already Afra is opening up for us to know? Nora? If you just wait for the microphone, yeah.
Basically love and eternal life, life after death. Those are the two biggest ones that I, the first that come to.
Sorry, I can't hear you well.
Issues of love,
yep.
And eternal life.
So what is he saying about those issues? What is the truth that he's telling us about those issues?
That divine love exists and that eternal life exists. Those are the two biggest ones that I can see. Straight away.
Yeah. So he very strongly emphasises, doesn't he, that there is a loving thing that's happening after I'm passing, that I can feel love inherent in what's happening. And he's also very much saying death is just I think he calls it a great change or a big change. It's just a change that's happened for me and it's nothing like what I was taught on earth it was. Yeah, cool. Did anyone else see any other issues of truth that were in the chapter? Yep. Alison?
The things that he was pointing out about religion, like about the dogmas of the church and how they don't line up with love and truth.
Yep.
That really struck a chord with me.
Yes, yeah. That struck a chord with a few people, I think. Anyone else? Yeah. And, as we get on to the third question, we can talk a bit more about the issues about morality and things that are brought up around that as well. Yeah. Danielle?
For me, when I was reading it and he passed across and he realised there was no death, he was still encountering and giving the story, and he was completely himself still. So there was no change of who he was.
Yes, so he didn't suddenly have loads more knowledge, and he didn't.
It was like, yeah, it just continued. Like, oh, yes. I'm here now. Oh, and this is happening. And
yeah. It's beautiful the way it's described, isn't it? Because you really feel that, Deb.
What I noticed was that God answers prayers and desires and longings when because the poor needed help and Frederick had a connection already with God, he was able to be used. His guides prompted, or high spirits prompted him to go and help, and that it demonstrates that God is loving and he uses us when he can.
Yeah.
And using this, Afra and the higher spirits answered, God's answering the prayer.
Yes, and we see that more and more through the book, don't we? That the just how specific the answers to God's prayers are. But certainly, even though he didn't know it, Frederick was being used because of his pure desire to serve. He had at least struck upon some truth in his life, hadn't he? He'd at least struck upon the truth that I don't think the church is right about this whole poor people not having any worth, and I'm going to actually serve them. Yeah, yeah. If we go to Bella.
That God's truth is unchangeable in comparison to man's truth.
Yes.
Especially when man's truth is only wanting to be seen to be doing the right thing.
Yes, yeah. So there's a different measure at work than what all the dogma is dictating. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
That we're not alone.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
It's very beautiful, isn't it? And, Julianne emailed me and she said that she just felt just so moved that life really does continue and that God provides for the souls that pass. When the spirit says to him, you're in the land of surprises, but you need not fear. That was very beautiful, I felt. Like immediately he's learning, wow, I don't have to be afraid. This transition, this death that I've been taught to fear all my life, immediately someone's there telling me, you don't have to be afraid. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it will bring for you nothing but rest and compensation. Yeah, very beautiful. Yeah, Barbara?
Just on that, it really brought home to me that, yeah, the passing through the mist was not painful. It was a joyous experience. Yeah. And that God caters for every soul, no matter what condition.
Yes. Yeah. 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 So even though he was observing that some people passing through the mist were doing it in different ways, someone was there for every single person. Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody missed out.
Yes.
And then the other thing was that when he described the boy... you know, from a boy who was dirty-faced, tattered, and then, you know, he had this angelic child in his arms.
Yeah, that was very beautiful.
So therefore, the true soul condition is revealed.
Yes.
Yeah.
That our spirit body is going to reflect our soul condition after we pass. Yeah.
My question on that was, do all children, and up to what age does that, you know, like this child was... I don't know, what was he, 7 or something? So he was very angelic-like and, you know, an artist would love to paint this person.
Yes.
So it's all children's souls that way?
Well, if you think about it, when we incarnate, all our souls are that way, according to the amount of damage we've already received. Remember, the majority of the damage that we need to clear now is the harm that we have actively done to other people.
Yeah.
This is what affects our spirit, our soul and our spirit body. It's the harm that we've done in avoidance of the harm that's been done to us, but it is still the things that we've done to harm others, the use of our will in an unloving way that affects the condition of our soul most harshly. So when a child is small and as they grow, they're beginning to engage their will more and more, and that will impact on how their spirit body looks. But when a child is 7 or 8, they're still very much largely under the control of the will of other people, and they haven't yet necessarily begun to exert their will in unloving ways. Yeah, yeah. So that's my understanding of it. Raj?
Thank you. What really touched me, and I think it's really relevant, is it's beautiful. There's no pain and there's no suffering. And he says, I reached and dragged him from his hazardous position and then turned and something touched me. I clasped the boy more firmly and stepped forward. The noise ceased, vehicles and streets faded away, as if some great magician had waved his wand. The darkness disappeared.
Yeah.
And to me, that's such a magic explanation of the demise of the body.
Yes.
And the event of the spirit body.
Yes. Yeah.
Arriving somewhere.
Yeah.
And because most of us have such a fear of that moment of death, and yet there is none.
Yes.
And to me, that's really the core of the whole thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
And to have given oneself in service, totally the ultimate sacrifice, as we might see it,
yep,
is just beautiful.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah,
very and, beautiful.
And what goes on, sorry, through the, all of the books is this incredible passion he has to go back.
Yes.
And tell everybody is nothing to be frightened
of. From the first chapter, that's his desire. Yeah. And I find that incredibly moving, that here is someone who's, he's so, this is obviously a pure desire within him, that he wants to ease the suffering of people around him, because some of his first thoughts are, how can I assist other people? Yeah, yeah, very beautiful. Mm. Yeah. Igor?
I just wanted to focus on the circumstances of passing, of his passing. Like, why did it happen? Could it be that he had hatred towards society in his soul, right? Could it be that that hatred sort of created this situation that he, you know, exit this world, maybe? Or?
I actually sort of feel that it's almost the opposite. Yes, his hatred towards society would create a certain set of circumstances surrounding him, but the young boy was in between the horses because of society's lack of love for him, for the young boy. Frederick had love for the boy, and so that love motivated him to attempt to save the boy. And in that sense, it was a purely loving act, and I feel it's more about the hatred of the world that caused his death. Yeah. I don't know. AJ, would you like to add to that? Do you feel anything?
Yeah, it was definitely the love that he had for the child. In fact, for love to motivate you to the extent that you would risk your own life for another person without even thinking. So he didn't contemplate, he didn't sort of go, oh, the child's in danger, am I ready to risk my life or not? I think I'll risk my life and then go and run and save the child. But the fact that he went and just automatically went and did it demonstrated how much love he had in his soul at that point. And so that's a very, very good reason as to why he arrived in the spirit world in a relatively good condition comparably, because most other people would have looked at the child in danger but then analysed their own potential danger in the situation and maybe not have even gone to rescue the child, and definitely not have gone to rescue the child as an automatic act. Mm-hmm. So the fact that it was an automatic act for him is a proof of how much love he had just for people generally, a child who he did not even know. Yeah.
And, go, Igor.
Just on that topic, if he would knew that he would die, like he obviously didn't know that by saving this child he would die, so he just automatically did it. But if the child was in the circumstances where he knew if he would enter that situation, he would definitely pass. Would that be a loving act for himself?
You see, when love motivates you, Igor, you don't. It's like if the building is burning. And I love a child so much that I want to save the child. I don't think, oh, I might die by doing this. I think I'm going to save the child. And that's the power of love motivating us. So I don't think it's that Frederick was oblivious to the fact that, like, if he used his reasoning mind, he would have gone, wow, there's a bunch of horses I'm about to jump under, I might die. But he didn't, because love motivated him. He just acted on the love that was within him. Is that how you would answer that, AJ? Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And also, can you see in your question, though, it's reflecting a sense that death is punishment or something bad for us, when Frederick's showing us that death is, if we live our life in love, then death is this beautiful transition. And he just, and that's one of the truths that no one's mentioned yet that I felt was in the chapter, and that is that progression and learning is always a part of our soul, even after death. And he's showing us that. So, yeah. Someone, if we go, Raj? Yep.
Well, then the question should be asked, is the law of attraction that that occurs in that moment that motivates him from the heart to do something spontaneous, it's almost like being called, because it starts him on a much greater journey than he's been on Earth.
Yeah, I suppose I haven't really analysed it that deeply, but he definitely acts on the love within his soul, and he attracts his death, which, if you think about it, he wouldn't have attracted that if there wasn't a lack of love in the environment around him. Mm. But there is, and he passes. And it does start. He encounters far more love in the spirit world than he ever has on Earth. So in a way, it's very beautiful for him. Yeah, yeah. Mm. Suze?
I just wanted to say that I feel that he was very, perhaps really hard on himself, calling himself a misanthrope.
Yeah.
Because you can see that, yeah, he just had a very clear sense of truth and a really loving heart. And, and I think his pain made him reclusive, but I don't think he was an unloving person ever.
No, I agree. And his journey in the spirit world is evidence of that, isn't it? Yeah. Hey, I think he felt so separate from society because there was some truth inside of him that... he also felt very judged by society, and that's why he would call himself a misanthrope or misanthropy, because that's how society would view him. Yeah, yeah, I agree. Yeah, yeah. Ange, did you have your hand up?
I was just going to say those same things, basically, along those lines, that his whole life was an expression of the love for the poor, for the weak. So it wasn't just a one-off incident, even, you know, throwing himself under the cart to rescue the child.
That's right.
And so it was just a natural progression that, like, the world didn't appreciate his love.
No.
He was ready for heaven. You know, it was obvious.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, we're still on the question of what truths are outlined in this chapter. Yeah? If we go to Renee.
I just felt that... a little bit about that the child was our little brother, and it was just a reminder that we're all brothers and sisters, and I just felt the depth of that we forget that.
Yep.
So to me that felt like a truth.
Yeah.
God's truth somewhere. Whether
Well, it is a truth, isn't it, that we're all, as children of God, absolutely. And the way Frederick lived his life was very much like that, wasn't it? He didn't feel strong affiliation with his earthly family that was left on Earth, but he definitely felt a sense of kindred or love. You know, he wanted to love people who he found were in poor conditions. He considered them his brothers, lovely. Millie?
Just the stark contrast of, like, religion with the architecture and the ritual.
Yes.
And the reality of the selfless act from a person who, you know, maybe when he was younger thought, well, that's the way that religion says you do it, but I'm going to follow my heart and do what I feel and what I actually feel from the Bible says to do.
Yeah.
And just the stark contrast of, well, actually, he did that selfless act without thinking, and he's just in a beautiful place.
Yeah, he showed a lot more spiritual development than some of the people he refers to in here.
So just the reality of that proof.
Yes, of what actually happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Elaine? Just here, Joy. Lainey, yeah.
If he hadn't already developed himself in love, even though he was misanthropy, he wouldn't have acted in that way unless just at that one moment he had celestial help to do so, would he? I mean, he was already developed in serving and loving.
I don't understand the question.
It was not like a one-off for him. It was maybe he was stepping towards... That was the ultimate service he provided, but... He had already been providing service.
Definitely.
Which developed his love to that point.
Well, see, and this is interesting. I feel that true service is born out of love. And when we truly love, it will draw us to service. Now, there are many people who act in service who are not in a state of love. And that to me is not true service. So I don't necessarily feel that service develops us in love. I feel that when we love, we are naturally drawn to service. And that his example definitely demonstrates that.
Which was actually what I was trying to say, thanks. That yeah. he always served in love, even though it seems like he was untrusting of other people, still when he served it was with full love and not just to serve to look good or... Because that was his job that week to do it for the church or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah. And I want to talk a bit more about that in the third question. But let's just quickly move on to the second question, which was how does all this truth that we've seen in this chapter relate to our own life and our own progression? This is the nuts and bolts, guys. Zenko.
What really struck me was when he was told the response he had about, you have been dreaming, now you're awake. And I definitely related that to my own life and my own facade itself.
Yes, yep.
And, just how much fakeness and is in my own life.
Yeah.
And I'm just starting to feel some of the reality, but...
Yep.
Yeah, it's just...
So this idea that we can live in a facade, and certainly what he talks about in the church is that a lot of people are living in facade.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's go to, Mon at the back. Just give everyone a turn to have a share.
What I found when he said that he was willing to sacrifice... his own place in heaven, and that the pearly gates could be shut upon me if by that means I could be some little consolation to the multitudes in hell. And for that, it showed in me how much selfishness I have within and how much judgment I have of those that are lesser than me, that I'd put myself first and... I'd want to be in heaven. I wouldn't sacrifice my place in heaven for hell just to be able to serve. Like the real desire in him to serve was so great.
It was very moving for me to read that, where he says, I would willingly sacrifice my place in hell if only to be some consolation to those multitudes in hell. It's such a beautiful sentiment. Also kind of wryly funny that he thought that the company would be better if it's the company of the people who frequent his churches, he'd prefer the company of the more humble people. Yeah. But, yeah, that's a great reflection, Mon. Barbara?
Thank you, Bonnie. That was beautiful, because that was really one of the best things in that part, actually. His willingness to serve is just very, very pure.
But how does this reflect on our own lives, you guys?
Well, yeah. I put down there that I had fear to serve at that level, and I had to look at doing that. But one of the biggest things that hit me on that one was that I just had gratitude for God that he caters for us all, mm-hmm. and even me.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so this is how I reflected on how does this relate to my life and my progression. I asked myself some questions. If we think about the issues of just divine truth that are outlined, we're going to talk about issues of morality and natural love, so we're getting a bit ahead of ourselves, but just the issues of universal truth that are outlined in this chapter, there is no death. That death is a transition and we can continue to progress and learn after death. That we're welcomed at death. That our spirit bodies reflect a change when we die, like the small boy who suddenly became this beautiful cherub. That people pass in various states and in various ways as they come through the mists. And also this issue of service, that service, pure service is a product of love. So how does this relate to my life? I ask myself the question, am I still living like death is an ending and that communication with the dead is impossible and that death is the worst possible thing that could happen? And for myself, yeah. I do feel like not necessarily my own death, but the death of my soulmate feels like a very final thing. And so if I'm going to use my study group to the maximum in the coming week, this is what I'm reflecting on. Wow, there's a truth here that I'm avoiding. It's a truth that's clear to me in many ways. I have much evidence of it as a medium and through the reading of it. But am I still living my life like there is death? The second thing that I asked that you, some of you have touched on is, do I neglect the knowledge of a spirit body which reflects my true condition? If I really know that my true condition is available to God, God's going to see it and my spirit body's going to reflect it and all the spirits around me and to some extent all of you, depending on how perceptive you are, am I still relying on my facade in my everyday life? Because if I am, I'm skipping over that truth, aren't I? Yeah. Any other reflections, you guys? This is where I feel we need to go with this. It's lovely to discuss the book. It's beautiful to discuss the book. It's a beautiful book. It's full of poetic prose that opens us to God very many times. But for me, on my progression, I'm asking myself these kinds of questions all the time because this is the real thing that's going to help me grow in love. Yeah. Graham?
One thing that got me was how he was considered a misanthrope,
yeah,
someone that dislikes people, and yet it turned out that he was exactly the opposite.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, what our society calls loving...
Absolutely.
The opposite.
Yeah.
Or unloving, yeah, is the opposite.
Yeah. And I find that challenging in my own life all the time because obviously AJ and I feel very passionately about this real love, the love from God and truly loving our brothers and sisters. But very often the things that we do are regarded as exactly the opposite by the society that we live in. And I suppose for all of us, it is to ask the question, do I have the courage of Frederick to live in a way that my heart is calling me, which will challenge society? If I can see the errors within society, how can society not be challenged if I act against in a more loving way that will challenge those errors? So I think also that he showed a lot of courage in his life. Yeah. To believe and to act that positively, you know, it wasn't just some random thoughts that he had in his mind. He didn't just read a book and talk about the book. He went, what does that mean? How does it look in life? And he acted, yeah. Yeah. If we go to Ange, yeah. And then to Deirdre after that.
Mary, I really loved the bit about... Well, just what I wrote here was, thus we learn of his complete satisfaction with the companionship and sweet communion in his worship and his trust in the leniency and righteousness of God to deal with him lovingly if in fact he has been misled. We're then acquainted with the task that is communion and relationship. No, sorry, that's not it. Yeah, where is it?
What page are you on,
it? The part where he talked... Oh, here it is. He served with love the language of God, and because of this ability and this love, his sermons were comprehended in every part, understood and appreciated, bringing forth fruit 60 or 100-fold. And I sort of reflected on how often do I do that in my life? You know, am I really serving the person that I'm talking to with truth and love, or am I just feeding an addiction, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah. Deirdre and then Renee. Yeah.
Hi. This sounds really awful to say, but in my 30s especially, I was acting like the church. I would only date men or seek men that were wealthy, and I even broke up with a boyfriend because he earned less than me.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty rotten.
But the key, Deirdre, is not to judge it. Remember, as
but
we're
I
asking...
But I did do it.
You did do it. And there's obviously an emotional reason that isn't love that caused you to act that way.
Yeah, I didn't want to be responsible for myself. I wanted someone else to provide for me.
Yeah, which covers a lot of fear of providing for yourself. Yeah. And that's the... It's wonderful that you read that and reflected and went, wow, that's me.
Yeah.
The key is then to look at why that's you. That's when the power of reflection comes into play, when we try to heal what we see within ourselves. Yeah, thanks. Go to Renee, and then we'll go on to the next question because there's a lot there. Yeah.
I found just knowing that being loving and thinking and loving others from a true heart will always land us in the right place. And I was feeling even just... hearing, being able to hear some truth and find, be here, feels like there was some love in me to be able to find this place in the first place, but still also reflecting on many areas and aspects of my life where I'm not as well, and why those things don't go the way I would love them to go because of the love, the true love that's not in
not
my heart
there.
And of service to others.
Yeah.
But that's about on the whole of the chapter, as well as having a relationship with God and being humble in that.
Julianne, who is in Brisbane, wrote and she said along those lines, but this is now we're getting into the third question, which is about the issues of natural love, morality, personal truth, divine love that I might be avoiding and thus hindering my own progression. She said, I was really confronted the first time I read the book how Fred had given a lot of himself to the needy. That's what we've been talking about a lot. He had come from a natural love for helping the less fortunate. She said, I felt a deep need to assess my life and see how unloving I had been throughout my life. It's clear that, you know, Frederick is demonstrating to us he also still had many injuries. He didn't pass in the third, fourth, fifth, sixth or seventh sphere. He's passed perhaps into the top of the first or the bottom of the second sphere. But already his life demonstrates to us a huge gift of service to humanity, doesn't it? So I reflect on that a lot as I read about what is it that I'm doing with those gifts that we talked about at the end of the preface, these gifts that God has given me. What is it that I'm doing about those things, doing with those things in terms of love and service to other people? Yeah. Danielle.
I felt the same way that of what you were just saying before about how he passed across and looking at ourselves and how we really are in spirit, and also, but just that one point when he looked at the boy and he had the gift of seeing the boy for what he really was, it just made me really emotional because we've all had those moments when we've connected to God and we've been open to that beauty, and then it goes away and you feel yourself to be, you know, dark and all these things. So just that gift that we get of the possibility
Beautiful. I feel you guys can be far more hard-hitting about how these things affect your life. Kel. Yeah. We go Kelly, then Alwyn. Yeah.
I reflected on how afraid I am to trust what the spirits communicate to me.
Yeah.
I just don't allow myself to take on board what is being communicated.
Yeah.
I'm sort of fearful that, oh no, that's bad, so I block it all out.
Yep. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the issue of blocking love and
yeah.
Cool. If we just go to Alwyn, just on your other side, Alwyn. Yeah.
Such a big one for me, but he was quite willing to talk about how he felt about the church, with the ministers in the church or whoever, without. And he said he didn't care if there was reproach or whatever. And that's just a huge, huge fear-based thing for me, that I avoid speaking the truth so much. And and it's because I'm fearful of my law of attraction. After I'm so fearful of it, it's really a huge thing for me.
So he's knowingly challenging a lot of people while he was on earth and then after he passed. So he has a loyalty to truth as well. Yeah, and definitely. And do you know what I found, Alwyn? And I'm pretty much in the same boat as you. I have a lot of fear about taking on truth in situations, but what I have found in my limited experience of practicing it is that often when we are totally loyal to the truth of what it is in that moment, so we don't try and embellish it, we don't try and water it down, then we're actually in harmony with God's laws for the first time, and all these things we fear, some of them might happen, but we feel supported in the process. We feel more in connection with ourselves and with God in that process. It's when we try kind of to namby-pamby around the truth, then God's got to give us more and say, look, you're just not on it yet. You know, this is not going to work out for you because you're not honouring the truth in this moment. While we were away, we stayed with some friends, and Fiona had this situation with someone in her life who she'd had a lot of conflict with in the past. Someone who... Oh, my gosh, now I've got an issue with telling the truth. Because it's not my story. I think I can tell it without personal details of hers. But she had had a long-standing issue with someone she had conflict with, and she was very frightened of this person. And she'd try to say the truth, but she was always trying to prevent their anger every single time, because she knew if I just say the truth to this person, it's going to go hell for leather. You know, there's going to be a lot of anger projected at me. And she had us staying with her for a few days, and we talked about a lot of issues of truth and love and how the truth is actually loving for yourself and everyone else. And lo and behold, her law of attraction brought her a situation with this person almost immediately, like the day later. And she decided to do something differently. And she didn't write an email, she didn't make a phone call, she drove to this person. And it took her 4 hours to drive, and all the way she was praying, can I just be loyal to this truth? Can I not go into anger or defence or attack or pleasing or whatever? Can I just be loyal to this truth? She got there and she was. Now, the reaction of the person was to literally scream in her face and threaten her with physical violence. But what she said was she felt so incredibly supported in that process. She couldn't believe it. She felt fear, but she also felt completely supported. She knew she'd honoured the truth. She knew she'd acted in the most love. She hadn't done anything she was ashamed of in the situation. And she actually came out of it with heaps less fear, heaps more respect for herself, and she had encountered something that she'd dreaded for years, literally years and years, and it wasn't as bad as she thought. Yeah.
Is that on?
Yeah.
I guess the other issue for me is I feel like I have no authority to say the truth either, just because of how difficult it is for me.
And I guess when we feel like we need authority to say the truth...
I guess the word is like genuineness, or you know what I mean?
Not quite. Tell me what you mean.
Authentic is probably a good word. And that, you know, sometimes I can see situations, but I haven't been through it myself and I haven't dealt with it myself. And how could I possibly say anything
so
about it?
That just requires humility, though, doesn't it? That requires that we're willing to step in and say, look, I can see this thing's happening here. I'm going to tell you that I haven't dealt with it yet and I really need to look at it. But I wouldn't be honouring the truth, me or you, if I ignored this. By not saying a truth in a situation where we know we also have error, we not only avoid the error for that person, but we also assist ourselves to avoid it in ourselves.
That's really helpful, thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, all right. Well, some things are... Oh, Joy, do you want to share something?
A big issue for me was this whole thing about all people being equal and everybody being helped.
Yeah.
And there's I've done some repentance, but there's a lot more in terms of how I view my brothers and sisters of the world.
Yeah.
I can be quite loving to people who are like me.
Yes.
And I find that I've been judgmental of people just because they don't agree with my beliefs.
Yes.
So there's a lot in that. That's a big minefield.
Yeah, absolutely.
And in terms of not even thinking that it's my issue to help people, I walk past people every day, I guess, who need help, and just walk past with closed eyes, with blinkers on.
Yeah. Karen in Sweden sent me an email, and she said the same thing. She said, the moral aspect of poverty, which I keep at a distance, became painfully close when I read the chapter. She says, in Sweden, we assume that the system takes care of everyone, which is not true. Yeah, yeah.
It's easy to always put it onto somebody else and not accept personal responsibility for how I treat every single person that's in my law of attraction. Doesn't matter where or what or...
Yeah, absolutely. And it poses the question, doesn't it? Do we really love if we can only love the people who are like us? Which I don't feel we do. It's not a pure love. It's not the kind of love that causes us to jump under the horses, you know. Yeah, yeah. Okay, some of the reflections I had from this chapter. On page 2, he talks about religion, and he says, there being much more form and fashion than solid worship or spirit in them all. So he's talking about all kinds of... He'd spoken to someone in contact with all kinds of different religious groups and is saying that their focus was on form and fashion. What do they mean by form and fashion? Nina? So this is a question I asked myself. I said, what does that mean and am I guilty of that? Not just the church. So go ahead.
In being concerned about how it looks to others so that you're in form with the dominant paradigm that you find yourself in.
Yeah.
So you're looking good according to the church, say, for example.
Yeah, yeah. It's about facade, isn't it? It's about fitting in, following the ritual and having a facade of spirituality. Yep. Yep. Jodie, you had your hand up. Did you want to say the same thing? Yeah, cool. Yeah, so I asked myself, okay, maybe I can see that in religion, but can I see that in myself? Where is my focus on facade rather than the true thing? We all come to lots of lectures, we all talk about our emotions, we all talk about God, but what is that a form of facade? How much am I in facade when I'm doing those things? Where is my true worship? And I asked myself, what does it mean to truly worship God? Does anyone have any ideas? Okay, sorry? I've got three basic things written down. We didn't confer. I wonder, are they the same? Do you want to share yours?
No, I was just going to use the
the tried and tested...
The truth, love and humility. Yeah. But what does that mean? What does that mean in our everyday life? And also, there's this aspect of worship. So, Alex, do you want to say, and I'll then say what I got. Oh, love, truth and humility. Yeah, okay. Well, we can actually love and we can honour truth and we can have humility but not have a relationship with God. Can't we? So what does it mean when we worship God? Yes, we can long for the divine love, which can be, and of course, immediately we've now established a personal relationship with God. But I can have natural love and I can honour truth and I can be humble. It doesn't mean I'm worshipping God. So I'll just tell you what I said and you can add to it if you like afterwards. For me, worshipping God means loving God. It means loving his laws and it means loving his creations. So if I looked at that definition, I thought, well, where's the true worship in my life? I can connect to a feeling like I really love God. However, sometimes I get really angry at God's laws. I don't want to have to feel my pain. I'm angry that the justice is in the spirit world and not on earth. Why is it always like that? You know, they're real emotions in me. And while I hold on to that anger, am I worshipping God? I don't think so. If I'm humble to that anger and I experience it and release it, then I'm closer to a true worship of God. So I have to own and acknowledge that. I can't deny that it's in me. But if I am self-righteous in my anger, then I've stepped away from God immediately and true worship. And the other part of that was love of his creations, which includes my brothers and sisters everywhere, which is partly what Joy was talking about earlier. So I do feel that if I truly worship God, then I would love each of you equally and abundantly. And so that brought me to look at a lot of issues around where is there still anger with other people, where is there still judgment of other people, especially people who I feel who have really harmed me. And this issue of service, which is a very strong feeling for me, how can I better embody that service in my life? Deb?
I'm interested in this subject of praise, and I don't know if Jesus would indulge us around, because I've been reading some Christian books lately, and I have done this in my life in the past. You know, praising God sounds real Christian, but it has amazing effect on your heart, you know.
Beautiful.
And even just thanking God, just the simple things. And even in thanking God, I feel like I'm no longer being so got so many expectations of being looked after, being grateful, you know, the simple. But
so the
it's probably big and I'd love to hear more.
It's big and it's actually a big thing for me at the moment as well because I feel, I was joking, I don't know who I was talking to about, but in some of the last talks that AJ's given in Mergen, I felt so inspired by what he was saying and the beauty of what he was conveying that I literally wanted to stand up and like praise God. I just wanted to be evangelical. I said to him, I wanted streamers and balloons to come from the ceiling and just go, yes, amen, that is amazing. I love that. And he said, why didn't you? Because you're too worried about what people think of you. So I feel that when we connect with God, of course, we're drawn to praise God. The issue is when it becomes an addiction. We can use it in a natural love kind of way. And I read a lot of Christian literature as well. And some of it I find is like natural love path for Christians because it's all about getting addicted to this idea of gratitude, which we have so many gifts to be grateful for, but helping the gratitude emotion, using that to help us skip over.
Natural love rather than physical.
Skip over the like, oh, but I feel hurt by certain things in my life. And if we just praise God more to get away from that, that thing is going to enter with us into the spirit world. Whereas I feel we can do both. And just like my friend Fiona, when she faced her fear and went, I'm so scared of this thing, but I want to be loyal to truth and God in this situation, she felt gratitude to God by facing what was difficult with inside of her, you know. She could have just gone, oh, there's that issue, but I'm so grateful for all the other gifts I've got in my life, and there's that issue, but I look at all the wonderful things I've got, and that would have been like the natural love path, and that issue would still remain within her. When we fully embrace God's laws, which is part of worship, you know, when we fully say, okay, I can recognise that that's loving, I will engage that because I trust and have faith that it's loving, then I feel this amazing gratitude is born, because we're not only just observing what's been given, we're interacting with it and we're partaking of the workings of God, the workings of the universe, and then this deep gratitude, like from our bones, kind of gratitude of thank you for free will. Thank you for the ability to heal. Thank you for this amazing way that you've designed everything that I can grow in love. And, yeah, no worries. Valine?
I'm going back to the worship,
yep,
which includes that. I've forgotten a little bit, but it was going to authenticity and the surprises that we have when we go over the other side will depend on how we've been following the stories that we want to believe in and our own facade.
Yeah.
And if I found that when I'm not connected and I feel like I can't worship God because I really don't really know how to yet, it was just, if I'm feeling that I want to be true, that I want to know God, it'll take me further into seeking the truth. And in doing so, I then long to worship God in that moment. I think it's a bit like what you were just saying, of one leading to the other.
Yeah.
You know, not I'm out there to worship God. It's just not knowing how to worship God, but seeking that will lead me through the stages that will get me there. And then I know God better. Yeah. And then I want to be grateful through knowing God.
Yeah. You know? Well, it's like so many things with God, isn't it? When we really engage the process or the thing, that whatever it is that is in front of us, immediately this cyclical thing, this building thing happens where we experience truth and then we experience love and then we, you know, that draws us to want to experience more truth and then we get more, and there's so many rewards at every moment. Yeah, yeah. I wanted to ask AJ if you want to add to this idea of what worship is, because that was just my feelings about what worship is.
I was just thinking that some had mentioned truth and some had mentioned love and acts of love and so forth, but I wanted to just sort of mention humility, yeah, again. It's very, in practical situations, it's very easy to be humble when you believe the person who's facing you, telling you some truth, is actually in a better condition than you are.
Yes.
So it's easy to be humble under those circumstances. And for many of us, it's also quite easy for us to be more humble when we're alone talking to God, because, you know, we automatically know that God knows everything about us, and so therefore we're more open about our facade. We drop our facade more. But when there's people around us who we feel are, who we may feel are lesser than us or don't know as much as we do, then there's a real test of humility. Because it's how we act with those people that really determines whether we're truly humble or not. And what I see happening with a lot of people who believe themselves to be on the path is that they are humble when they interact with myself or Mary or somebody else, less so with Mary perhaps than with myself. But when they interact with each other or with other persons who they believe are not on the path, their humility just goes out of the window. Mm-hmm. Like, and instead of being humble anymore, they are now quite arrogant and overbearing and inconsiderate. Yeah. And we just often see many examples of that. And I just feel that's an indication that we're not yet really learned humility to be humble. We would need to be humble in those circumstances as well. And actually every single person would find it a pleasure to be around us, not just the people who believe the same things we believe or anything like that. And I feel that's one way we demonstrate that we really get worship of God too, like this
Definitely.
Understanding
yeah.
that if we are truly humble, we will no longer treat any person on the planet as if they are lesser than us.
Yeah.
We will no longer act in a manner that's overbearing or unloving towards any person on the planet, no matter whether they have no knowledge of divine truth or whether they have more knowledge of divine truth, we'll treat them exactly the same.
Absolutely. Mm. Yeah. And I guess that's the thing we're talking about, acting in truth or loving our brothers and sisters, but none of that can commence unless we're first willing to be humble. And thanks, babe. It's beautiful. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead, Raj, and then I'll...
Which must equally apply off the planet or out of humanity in the spirit world. I've personally, in my looking at this and highlighting my avoidance, I realised that I've been really judgmental about whether or not I'm going to talk to loving spirits or do they have to be celestial spirits.
Yeah.
And I find that really false. And I'm guilty of that, and I realise that's really stopped a lot of my mediumship.
Mm.
And I've been reluctant to do it.
I
won't do that anymore, and the book's really highlighted that for me.
Yep.
Otherwise I wouldn't have even been able to talk to such a beautiful being who passed over. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. It's a big desire for me that this book group might also inspire people to mediumship, because there's so much love there that's available for us, but also there's so much love that there's so many ways that we may be able to serve those people who are perhaps not in such a great condition with our own humility, with our own truth, and with what love we have to help them grow. And it's a huge need, as you're all aware, coping with negative spirit influence. If we can love those people and serve them, with so much potential. Yeah. Nina, and then Barbara.
I feel we worship God when we involve God. So for me, there's a big tendency to do everything on my own without God, this whole trip of self-reliance.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm seeing even now, just sitting here, how worship is involvement, you know, inviting God in.
Definitely, yeah. I love that God didn't design anything to be passive, you know. It's like we don't have to wait. We don't have to... if we engage our inherent inquisitive, playful natures, if we ask, if we long, if we do all these things, then God can... we get to know ourselves better, but also God, we can come to know God. And, I love that, yeah. Okay, I'm conscious of the time. Does anyone have... it's 2:20 already, yeah, okay. We need to just buzz through the rest of it, all right. There's just a few more points that I wanted to mention about this emphasis on form and fashion than solid worship or spirit. And talking about love of God's creations, talking about judgment of others. And then I wanted to ask you the question, there's a lot about the church that he mentions, and Julianne as well emailed me something about that which I thought was quite pertinent. She says, I was quite surprised at how angry I felt towards religion and the effects it had on preventing my relationship with God. It was so full of dogma and created such a feeling of fear of God that I completely shut down any desire to have a relationship with him. I feel robbed that I hadn't grown with the natural feeling of receiving his love. I now struggle to believe in the love. Does anyone else relate to those feelings from the chapter? Yeah, yeah, totally. I think this is the case for a lot of people, that they feel robbed by the errors in religion. But what I was going to ask you about in terms of our facade versus our worship is how many of us now feel as if many of the people feel that he described in the book in churches that feel quite righteous. Like, how many of us feel righteous because we've found the divine truth, that we know the truth? One person's willing to admit it. Cool. Yeah. So this places us with an emphasis on form and fashion rather than the true qualities of what it is the divine truth is about, which is, as AJ mentioned, humility in every circumstance, desire to love and serve in every circumstance, and not a manufactured desire, but a true, like, wanting the truth of what's in us right now will lead us to this love. And if we feel like we've got it all sorted out just because we've watched a few DVDs and can parrot some things about causal emotion and the spirit world or God, it doesn't necessarily mean that we're more righteous than anyone. In fact, in some ways, it makes us puts us in a worse condition, yeah, than a lot of other very humble people out there who will openly say, "Look, I don't know." Jeanette.
Mary, I actually feel depraved.
Depraved.
As opposed to the other word.
What do you mean, Jeanette?
As opposed to righteous.
Ah, I see.
Yeah. For sure.
Yeah. Yeah. The truth is, you're not really depraved, are you? But you can feel the errors inside of your soul. Yeah. And I can relate to that feeling too. Yeah. Yeah. I said that the love of God and God's creation draws us to service of others regardless of their background. It draws us to forgiveness, humility and integrity in our dealings. And that's some of what AJ, I think, was also touching on. Like, if we're truly humble, if we're truly not taking this path of judgment of others just because we know the truth, then we're going to have a lot more integrity with everyone. We're going to want to connect with everyone on a real level, not just the people we feel safe with. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, look, I had quite a few other reflections on how I can apply this chapter to my life and the different issues of natural love and divine love and morality that were highlighted. Does anyone else have anything burning that we can just cover a few things just quickly, and perhaps I can leave you with some questions? Danielle?
Actually was burning inside.
Burning.
Yeah, I'm going to use that word. When you were talking about all the things we're learning and the gift of mediumship, because there are people in need, I'm working at the moment with a lot of people. That's my job. And I feel as passionate as you do about the people in Kingaroy, because that's the area I work in Anango. Yeah. And there is a lot of people out there that need our help, that need the knowledge, that need the support. I don't talk to them about divine love, of course, but so the mediumship in our dealing with our brothers and sisters on earth, it's really important. Everything you said, just to be aware that every single person around us, not necessarily just the spirit world, is in great need.
Yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. It's been really, really thrown at me, like, on an hourly basis, how unaware people really are.
Yeah, I
not
think
dumb
we need to be
ignorant.
Careful. Yeah, of arrogance.
I'm
as
not
well.
Meaning that.
Saying they really need us.
No, I don't mean that. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how to explain it, but I wouldn't look at them in any different way than if a spirit came to me or another person or someone that I knew from this group. Yeah. I wouldn't look at them in that way. But what I'm saying is, I guess, about God, about the God's truths, that's what I'm relating to, not about, oh, you're less than me or I'm better than you.
So. Yeah. AJ wants to comment, actually. So,
Danielle, it's interesting because in the God's Way of Love organisation, we are actually thinking of cancelling the mediumship team.
Yeah.
And the main reason why we're thinking of cancelling it completely is because we feel almost everybody who comes along to that team is not in a place of wanting to serve and not in a humble place with their mediumship. So we were hoping, partly one of the things Mary was hoping from this discussion of a man's mediumship, which is Robert James Lee's mediumship, there's a man there who is in obviously a humble enough condition to receive some pretty good truths and deliver those to the world. But I don't know if you've read some of the other books, but he was also willing to help some of the darker spirits in the process as well. And one of the things that we're very, very concerned about is oftentimes we see mediumship being used as a tool to make a person look better or to denigrate others, a tool used to make other people feel bad about themselves or look bad or to make themselves feel that they're better than somebody else. And we see that as a general problem in the entire team. And so much so that we don't feel there's even a leader who's able to maintain a humble enough space for the team to grow into this humble place of helping other people, but also helping spirits. One of the things we notice in particular is there's very few people who have a desire to help spirits because there's less rewards helping spirits. So when you give your mediumship to somebody else who's on earth, often you get a feeling which is often addictive, but they just love you, isn't it? It's wonderful. I just got to talk to my God and you're wonderful and all these kind of things go on. But when we're actually speaking to spirits, helping spirits, we don't get all of that emotion generally from a person on earth. In other words, we don't get our addiction met. And myself and Mary see that as a real problem for that team. And so we're hoping that through this process, everyone can be a bit more self-reflective about their own desire to help others in a true way, rather than a desire to help others by looking down upon them or making yourself feel better about yourself or any of those other things. And so I just thought it was an ideal time to mention that. Mm. So we're still unsure what we're going to do with the mediumship team, but at this stage, we're probably going to temporarily cancel the mediumship team until we feel there's people who love mediumship but also have this passionate desire to remain humble and remain in a condition of service rather than wanting their own emotions served by the process. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And certainly my dream is that we would, God's Way of Love would benefit the entire world ultimately, but the entire community surrounding us, not just people who share our belief system. So, yeah. Okay, Rita, is this about the... Okay, all right.
I have been almost every time going to the mediumship in Kayabra, which is also tonight. And my opinion is that it does help lower spirits, because our lower spirits come and we talk to them.
Yep.
So I hope it's not cancelled.
Not in Kayabra.
Maybe I have.
Just in Queensland.
Just in Queensland. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And the other question is, it triggered me when you said the desire to love and serve in every circumstance, because I had that Catholic addiction and upbringing to serve and to love, and yep, that triggered me again.
But was it true service that you were...
No, but I can't. I'm not there with true service, so... Mm-hmm. So where do I go now?
Well,
I'm just trying to find what I want.
Yes, absolutely.
And now I think, I have to love and serve again.
When we truly serve, we don't feel it like a burden. We don't feel it like, I've got to do this.
No,
we go, I really want to do
this.
No,
I just want to say it was more of an addiction, so I didn't never felt it as a burden. I felt happy doing it.
Yeah.
But then later I learned it's an addiction.
Like lots of addictions, they get to be burdensome after a while. Yeah. So your question is, what should you do? I think
my question is, I'm just triggered by that. I feel if I don't love and serve, I'm doing something wrong. Or maybe in my true heart, I am really wanting to serve, but I am not looking at myself, what I really want for myself.
Yeah, can you see that if you just embody the principles that we talked about humility, about truth, then your even just humility, your true desires would be revealed to you very rapidly. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. And already something's triggered for you, which is about the feeling like I have to serve. And
well, I did something wrong.
Yes.
I should have more considered everybody else and others and not me.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, no worries. All right. We must be at time. Yeah. There's just one last thing that I wanted to raise with you guys. And that was about the theme about the corruption of the wealthy in this chapter. And so perhaps I can leave it as a side question. Does poverty equal goodness, and does wealth equal evil or sin? Yeah, we say no, but a lot of us have the feeling of yes. And that's what was triggered for me. Yeah. So just more food for thought for the next week. I just ask you for a bit of feedback now about the way we're running, the way it went. My idea is that each week when we meet, we might spend 5 minutes maximum summarising the chapter. Then we would spend a bit of time discussing things that people didn't understand. What were the words? What was the parables? Is there any theme? What were they trying to say here? That kind of thing for another 10 minutes or so, or however long it takes. And then we would go into the questions. And if we can stick to the questions fairly strictly, then we look at the issues of universal truth that are presented, things that we know, like that we can see to be truths. So we don't go into the themes or the emotions that were triggered for us. We just talk about what are the truths. And that doesn't have to be either a long discussion. Where I would prefer to spend the majority of our time is on how do these truths affect my life and how, you know, what does this mean? And then on what were the issues of natural love, divine truth and morality that were brought up for me, and how do these impact on my progression? That's where I'd like to spend those final two things, where I'd like to spend the majority of our time. How does that sound for everyone? Yeah, okay. It's a bit like sloppy this week, so I'm just finding my feet and all that. But if you're happy with that, is there any other questions or feedback about how things run? I'll try to stick to time because I know you've all got other commitments. Nothing, AJ?
Just a practical thing, babe, that after these sessions, we're actually we're using the same auditorium in every pretty much presentation we have for a series of interviews. And so that's going to mean most of us being willing to move out fairly quickly so that we can get set up for those series of interviews. Yeah.
Which is another exciting thing that's going to be happening. So you'll see more interviews with AJ on YouTube. But if you can respect the space, because we're just hiring a space for a certain amount of time, you guys will clear out, we'll start interviewing. So, Joy?
We can just ask people to stack the chairs up.
That would be beautiful. Thank you.
And then we can shift them.
Yeah. Alex? No, it's not. So it's on my blog under book group, more info or something, the latest one, and it tells you the days and times. Next week is Wednesday at 12:30 in the main hall, which is just here on the corner. So, and that's because after that we'll do interviews, and after that we have karaoke. So, yeah. Thanks everyone for your enthusiasm and engagement. It was great. Yeah. Look forward to doing this with you.